we just jumped the fence until it became apparent that we were beginning to destroy the fence. And the German landowner was not very happy with us. And so he became pretty angry with us. And so the new rule was, stop jumping the fence. Yeah, right. So we kept jumping the fence. And I remember one day, I don't remember which one of my brothers, so I'm the oldest of four. And my mom and dad would always be, you know, listen to your brother. Follow your brother. Do what your brother says. Like, I'm the model citizen, like leading them. So anyways, one day we jumped the fence, and one of my brothers gets his pants stuck on the fence. It became this issue between the German landowner, and the rule was for our building, do not jump the fence anymore. You've got to walk all the way around if you're going to do this. So again, it became more of an obstacle, less of a boundary for us. And we continued to jump the fence. And then I think finally, there was a gate on the fence. So finally, he just unlocked the fence. I don't know why he didn't do that years before. So again, it becomes this issue of, we always look for shortcuts. Like, the shortcut here is, I want to play with them. I'm going to jump the fence that stands right here rather than walk 10 minutes or 15 minutes all the way around. Caused issues, caused this almost not to the point of an international incident, but I'm sure in some people's minds it was. But the reality is that there are no shortcuts in life. They may feel like shortcuts. You may think you're saving 5 minutes, saving $5, saving a little bit of time, but the reality is there really are no shortcuts, especially when we come to this issue in chapter 16 of Genesis. There are no shortcuts to a life of faith built upon the promises of God. But the promises of God that he holds up for us, holds out to us, that we hear, that we believe, and then we somehow in our minds think aren't true, we begin to shortcut them. There are no shortcuts. So 2 points this morning. You can follow along on the back of the bulletin if you'd like. The first is there in verses 1 to 6, a costly shortcut along the way. I want you to see three things when we look at verses 1 to 6. And again, the text was just read. We're going to work our way back through it. The first thing that I want you to see, that this costly shortcut, and the costly shortcut here is for Abram and Sarai, is a lack of confidence in God's word. The very first thing we see here in the opening verses of chapter 16 is a lack of confidence in God's word. Look at verses 1 and the first half of verse 2. Now Sarai, Abram's wife, had borne him no children. In the promise to this point from chapter 12, God calls Abram and Sarai out of the land of Chaldeans and says, I'm going to make of you a great nation. And to this point, there's been no children. You don't have a nation if there's no children. So she knows this. They know this. She had, to this point, no children. She had a female Egyptian servant whose name was Hagar, probably comes with them when they left Egypt, the debacle there in chapter, second half of chapter 12. And Sarai said to Abram, Behold, now the Lord has prevented me from bearing children. Go in to my servant. It may be that I shall obtain children by her. Beneath every sin, not just here, not with Abram and Sarai, not just with Adam and Eve, not just with every person that we read about in the Bible, but your life and my life and everyone's life on planet Earth, beneath every single sin, first and foremost, is a distrust in the Word of God. It always starts there. It will always start there. You can still hear the echo of the serpent from Genesis chapter 2 and chapter 3 today. Did God really say? Did God really promise you that? Does God really hold this out for you? And so you hear that echo every time you and I engage in sin. Is this echo from the garden of this serpent? Did God really say? You can trace back every liberal denomination today back to its roots, and at some point there was a distrust, a dismantling of the authority of the Word of God. That's where it will always begin. It will always begin there for you. It will always begin there for me. It will always begin there for everyone, is a distrust and a lack of confidence in the Word of God. Because the promise that was made in chapter 12 was made explicitly to Abram. The Lord said to Abram, go, I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great so that you will be a blessing. Notice that it's made explicitly to Abram and implicitly to Sarai. So for her, there could be this sense of shame and humiliation. Maybe she viewed herself as a failure or a hindrance to the promise. Look, I'm standing in the way. God said he's going to do this through you. Maybe the problem's with me. They've been in the promised land. Now, verse 3 tells us for 10 years. 10 years, in some sense, isn't very long. And in other senses, it's a long wait. It's a long time to wait to say, when is this child coming? We're getting older. Mobility is becoming more difficult. We're still living in this land that's foreign to us. God, when is this coming? So Sarai sees a shortcut. We've been here 10 years. I think I've got an idea that will actually, according to chapter 17, verse 1, cost them another 13 years. It's not like God says, you guys, you're brilliant. Tell you what, you want to make this happen now. Tell you what, we'll just make it happen now. That's actually not what happens. Sarai comes up with a quote-unquote brilliant idea to speed this along. Brisket, on average, for me, takes 18 to 20 hours in a smoker to cook, to do it well. I could throw it in a microwave and microwave it for 12 minutes. It's not going to taste the same. Right? If you're a cook at all, like even if you cook mac and cheese, you know it takes time. Then you compound that. If you're making a roast, you're making a brisket, you're making Thanksgiving dinner, there's no shortcut to this. Right? You can think in your mind that you're making a shortcut, which will actually, you don't want to come over to my house if I've microwaved a brisket for you. I don't want to come to your house if you've microwaved Thanksgiving dinner for me. There really is no shortcut to this. God doesn't need you and I to sprinkle Miracle-Gro on his word. We are called to trust. We are called to trust his word, his timing, his promises. I say Miracle-Gro because Isaiah 55, listen to what is communicated here about the word of God. For as the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return there, but water the earth, making it bring forth and sprout, giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes from my mouth. It will not return to me empty. It will accomplish that for which I purpose it, and shall succeed in the thing for which I sent it. It's amazing that the rain that comes, that waters, that brings seed, that brings forth a crop, and then it's harvested, and then it brings produce. It brings here, bread. God is saying, my word is like this. Just simply trust it. Take me at my word. Believe me. Don't try to shortcut it. One of the things that we talked about last week is that righteousness comes at the beginning of the Christian life, not the end of it. Right? So just last week we saw in chapter 15, verse 9, Abram believed the Lord and he counted it to him as righteousness. And the point that I made last week that we need to hear again and again and again is that we are declared righteous before a life of faith. Righteousness is not a gift at the end of a life of faith. Right? The evidence of that is here. If this was a test, Abram, are you going to prove yourself faithful so that I can demonstrate my love to you? He would have failed. The reality is that Abram is declared righteous, and then comes the life of faith. It's the same with you. It's the same with me. When we believe the gospel, you are declared, and I'm declared righteous because of the work of Jesus, period. Then comes the life of faith. Because if it came at the end, let's be honest, you would be out, and I would be out, Abram would be out, we'd all be out. Because that's not where the test comes. The declaration is made at the beginning, and then the life of faith comes. It comes right here. This chapter comes on the heels of this amazing covenant that God makes with Abram in chapter 15. One commentator says, there are no perfect feet that walk the path of faith. Donald Barnhouse did. There are no perfect feet. You and I are not perfect. We are righteous, yes. We are not perfect. And every foot that walks, every pair of feet that walk, every foot that hobbles along the path of faith is righteous, not perfect. And Paul makes a similar statement in 1 Corinthians chapter 10. Those that stand, take heed lest you fall. So there's a warning here for us as we look at this to say, what do I learn about my own heart in how Sarai comes up with a shortcut here? So first, there's a lack of confidence in God's word. Always coupled with that is a pattern of conformity to the world. Every time we disbelieve God's word or we don't trust God's word, there's a pattern in the world that we will conform to. That's what happens here. Second half of verse 2 and verse 3, and Abram listened to the voice of Sarai. So after Abram had lived in the land 10 years, Sarai, Abram's wife, took Hagar the Egyptian, her servant, and gave her to Abram, her husband, as a wife. Again, this comes after chapter 12, but it's the same pattern as chapter 12. The call there was to walk by faith, not by sight. Because what Abram does there is walks by sight and not by faith. They go into Egypt, and he throws his wife under the bus. Remember, you're beautiful. They're going to think you're my wife, so tell them you're my sister. It's going to go better for me if you do this. Trust me, honey. It's going to be great. We're not going to need counseling. You're not going to need any therapy after this at all. It's going to be great. Right? Then they go in, and they take her. They take her as Pharaoh's wife, because they walked by sight and not by faith. And it's the same thing here. And actually, the very pattern from Egypt is now reversed. Remember, they go in. Abram gives his wife over, in some sense, to an Egyptian ruler, to Pharaoh himself. And now Sarai does the very same thing. She gives Abram over to an Egyptian, not ruler, but servant. Right, and we could say to Abram and Sarai, how slow are you to learn? And they would say to you, how slow are you to learn? This is a picture, again, not just of the heroes of the faith and the pitfalls that they experienced. This is a picture of you and me. It's a picture of our hearts that within 10 years, he's doing the very same thing. It's the very same pattern. And we'll see by the time we get to chapter 18, he does the very same thing with his wife. Tell him you're my sister again. This is the pattern. We are slow to learn. But again, always coupled with the distrust in God's word is that everything in the world around us will begin to sound reasonable. I can't tell you, every time I'm on Facebook, which is not a ton, but someone will post something and look at what God told me. Look at what God said to me. And there's enough truth in it that sounds reasonable and enough falsehood that this just is absolutely destructive and dangerous. We were in Chicago this week, so I didn't have time. I was going to pull up a couple of those, hopefully not from none of you, just other friends that I have, of these bad theological statements. But one that I hear over and over and over and over and over and over is that God just wants me to be happy. God wants me to be happy. I think it's okay that I divorce my husband because God wants me to be happy. I'm going to do this. I'm going to engage in this. I'm going to walk away from this because God wants me to be happy. Happiness is not a fruit of the Spirit. Very rarely when you read the Bible will you see anything related to happiness. Joy, yes. Contentment, yes. Happiness, no. We'll see as this text ends that the call here for Hagar isn't one of happiness. God is more concerned with your holiness and my holiness than he is with our happiness. If there's a list, that's the bottom. Underneath everything else, maybe if happiness makes the list at all, it's at the bottom. And in our consumer mindset, our entitled mindset, we put it number one, maybe number two. It's not about our happiness. The question is, do you recognize God's word enough to be able to discern what's true and what's false? When these statements come up on social media and you're like, that sounds really good. It's got 422 likes. There's people I know that have commented. This must be true. Does it actually align with God's word? Most of the time, it doesn't. Now, there are a number that do, so please don't hear me. And I'm not trolling your Facebooks and Twitter accounts. Nobody's on Twitter anyways, but Instagram, just seeing, like, I've got better things to do. You've got better things to do, too. Now, the question is, do we recognize God's word? But the sad part here, in verses, second part of verse 2 and verse 3, is this is the very same language that's used when Eve tempts Adam, gives Adam the forbidden fruit. It's the very same language. It's identical. Here, Abram listened to the voice of Sarai. There, it's Adam listened to the voice of his wife Eve. Here, Abram had lived 10 years in the land. Abram's wife took, there's the same word from Genesis chapter 3, took Hagar, the Egyptian, her servant, and gave her to Abram, her husband. Substitute Adam and Eve, substitute an apple, a serpent there lurking in the dark. In Genesis, it's not in the dark. Here, it's behind the scenes. It's the same exact pattern. It's identical. It's always that way. Nothing wrong with listening to your wives. Men, don't go home and say, well, see, I can't listen to you. The Bible says that every time men listen to their wives, it goes bad. No, that's not the point here. He obeyed his wife knowing the promises that were held out for him. Something about this doesn't jive, Sarai. God told me this. You're telling me this. I should go with what God is commanding here, what God has held out for me. I should lead you in a way that points you to the hope of the promises of God. So it's not just that he listened to her. It's that he knows the opposite to be true. And rather than obeying God, they appeal to social conventions in both the giving of Hagar and their treatment of her. Both of those are seen here. There's some laws that were current during the time of the writing of these stories. One of them is the Code of Hammurabi, the law of Hammurabi. And it allowed two things. The first is that it gave authority of children born to concubines to their mistresses. So Sarai knows this. What's happening in culture, they're doing this. It works for them. Let's try this. Because if I bring her in, give her to you, she has a child, it becomes mine. And therefore, I fulfilled God's promises for you. God didn't, I did. The second is Hammurabi Law 146 that allows for the mistreatment of a slave or a concubine if they claimed equality with their mistress, which is exactly what happened. We'll see that eventually, that she has one up on Sarai. And so she looks at her with contempt. And so Sarai knows, you're looking at me this way, I can mistreat you, and I can treat you however I want according to the laws of the times, according to the customs of our days. Let me just say that what is culturally acceptable is not the same as what honors God and conforms to his will for our lives. Because what's culturally acceptable, what's popular, what's trending today and tomorrow is the wrong barometer for your life. If you're looking for a test, do not use culture as an example. Acts chapter 5, verse 29, a couple of the disciples are there. Peter and the apostles are told to be quiet. And they answered, we must obey God rather than men. That has to always be our default. Because cultural pressure against us for standing according to the Bible, standing according to the revealed word of God, it will cost you. It cost the apostles. It cost people through church history. It will cost you as well. The call for us is not cultural conformity. And as I said a couple weeks ago, quoting Frank Bruni from the New York Times, you can believe whatever you want, right, in your heart, in your home, and in your pew. Just don't bring it out into public. No, absolutely not. We are called to bring it out into public. the result of these two things, a lack of confidence in God's word and a pattern of conformity to the world, results in the absolute destructiveness of sin. Verses 4 to 6, and he went into Hagar, and she conceived, and when she saw that she had conceived, she looked with contempt on her mistress. And that was enough for them to treat her the way that they do. Notice from this point forward, they don't even refer to her as Hagar, but simply the servant. And Sarai said to Abraham, may the wrong done to me be on you. It's your fault, by the way. I gave my servant to you, to your embrace. And when she saw that she had conceived, she looked on me with contempt. May the Lord judge between you and me. But Abram said to Sarai, behold, your servant is in your power. Your servant, don't even call her by name. Your servant is in your power to do to her as you please. So Sarai dealt harshly with her, and she fled from her. The word contempt here that Hagar has for Sarai means to view as worthless. So she belongs to them. However this went down, as they left Egypt and Pharaoh gave them all this stuff, she belongs to them. And now she conceives and she views Sarai as worthless. Again, Hagar had one up on Sarai. She could provide what Sarai couldn't. It's amazing, in Proverbs chapter 30, verses 21 and 23. Listen to this. Under three things the earth trembles, under four it cannot bear up. So in Proverbs, you'll see this pattern. In poetry sometimes, they'll say, here's three things and a fourth. And it's the fourth that's the most important thing. So under three things the earth trembles, under four it cannot bear up. A slave when he becomes king, and a fool when he is filled with food. An unloved woman when she gets a husband. And what's the fourth that the earth cannot bear up? A maidservant when she displaces her mistress. We see that here. Hagar knows, right? She's the boss now. I am the fulfillment of the promises that God has made to you two that you couldn't do. Now I'm looking on you as worthless. And things go from bad to worse. It's sin all the way around. For Sarai, she has sinned against God. She's sinned against Abram. She's sinned against Hagar. She's ultimately sinned against herself. The best laid plans for them, for you, for me, the best laid plans outside the will of God aren't worth an ounce of consideration. I got a great idea. The first question you should ask is, does this fit with God's word, God's plan, God's promises? If it doesn't, then don't walk that path. That should have been the question that Abram asked. But notice she points the finger at him and basically, I think it's the NIV, basically says, you're guilty. You're responsible. This isn't my fault. I know I had the plan. It was your call to approve or deny it. But it's your responsibility. It is always easier to blame others and to lash out at them instead of dealing with our own sin. Anybody and everybody becomes a target. It's not safe. When you're not able to deal with your own sin, your own guilt, your own shame, well, anyone and everyone will be a target. And here it was the servant. It was Hagar. That's a costly shortcut along the way. Verses 7 to 16, there's a costly detour back home. Again, three things I want you to see in these verses. The first is the beauty of grace. The beauty of grace. Listen to verses 7 and 8. So Hagar has just fled. Verse 7, the angel of the Lord found her by a spring of water in the wilderness, the spring on the way to Shur. And he said, Hagar, servant of Sarai, where have you come from and where are you going? She said, I'm fleeing from my mistress, Sarai. So Hagar starts heading home, what she knows as home. Shur, here in verse verse 8, is on its way back to Egypt. It's northwest Sinai on the border of Egypt. So she's going, "This is not safe for me here. I'm going home. I'm going back to my roots. I'm going back to where I know it was safe." And the question that I thought of is, where do you and I run when nothing else feels safe? Where's home? Where's the past life that you go, this is clearly not working here. Where am I running? There's always a spot that you'll run to, a spot that feels familiar, feels safe, feels convenient. It's not near, because here it's all the way back on the border of Egypt. But what's the old land for you? And I say the beauty of grace because grace meets her before she gets there. She doesn't make her way home. She's on her way home, and grace meets her. And this figure appears a number of times in the Old Testament. And many scholars would say this is the pre-incarnate Jesus. When you see the language, the angel of the Lord, this is Jesus. Before he takes on flesh and dwells among us, it's Jesus. And I think there's a case to be made for that here. The angel of the Lord meets her. At the end of her interaction with this angel, verse 13, so she called the name of the Lord who spoke to her, "You are a God of seeing." We'll look at that in a minute. But she recognizes not just that this is a messenger from God, this is God. Some of the promises that are made, it's "I will," in verse 10, "I will surely multiply your offspring." A messenger can't say that. My master will do that. But this angel declares, "I will surely multiply your offspring." By the time you get to chapter 48, just before Joseph kind of appears on the scene and the whole of Genesis focuses on him, you have the last of the patriarchs, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And Jacob makes this statement in Genesis chapter 48, verse 16. "The angel redeemed me from all of my evil." It's the angel that does this. So again, it's not a point of contention. If you disagree, that's okay. But many scholars believe this is Jesus here before he takes on flesh, enters human history, takes up a zip code and nerve endings and all of those kinds of things. But what we have here is an Egyptian woman at a well met by, I would argue, and I believe, the pre-incarnate Son of God. Remarkable that in John chapter 4, it's a very similar story. You have a woman at a well. Jesus is there engaging with her. But what's profound here is that this angel sees her amidst her brokenness. He doesn't just see the situation. He sees her in the midst of her brokenness, in the midst of this situation of feeling battered, now pregnant, on the run, no place that's home, and he loves her. And some of the promises that are given here, this interaction is a profound one. I want you to look for just a couple of minutes at John 4. There's so many remarkable comparisons there that are seen here with this angel and Hagar at this well. Again, John 4, the disciples leave. Jesus said, "Go find something to eat." And he stays there, and this woman comes out, a Samaritan woman, right? So that's the enemy. One, men don't talk to women most of the time in this situation. Two, she's Samaritan. Three, it's at noon, right? So there's clearly some issues here. Nobody goes to gather water from a well at noon. It's the hottest time of the day. So you have, she's a woman, she's a Samaritan woman, she's clearly a broken Samaritan woman. And it doesn't take very long to see Jesus talking to her about the water at this well. So he tells her, "Give me a drink." Says the disciples, verse 8, the disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask for a drink from me, a woman of Samaria? For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans." And Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that's saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you have nothing to draw water with. The well is deep. Like you've been in the sun too long. You can't get water from this well." And he's going, "No, you missed the point." Then they argue or debate a little bit about whose well this is. And he tells her, everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never be thirsty again. The water that I give will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life. And the woman said to him, Sir, give me this water so I won't be thirsty. I don't have to come here to draw water anymore. So again, she misses the point. And again, he pursues her. Go call your husband. Well, I don't have a husband. Well, you're right. You're right in saying I have no husband, for you've had five. And the man that you're living with now is not your husband. So he engages with her, loves her. She goes back to the village and compels them to come. Verse 39, many Samaritans from that town believed in him because of the woman's testimony. He told me all that I ever did. So when the Samaritans came to him, they asked him to stay with him. And he stayed there 2 days. And many more believed because of his word. They said to the woman, it's no longer because of what you said that we believe, for we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this is indeed the Savior of the world. It's an amazing interaction with Jesus and this Samaritan woman at the well. And it's a very similar picture here with Hagar, this Egyptian woman living in a foreign land, now at a well, on her way back home, and Jesus, this angel of the Lord, meets her, sees her in the midst of her brokenness, sees her in the midst of her shame, and loves her. There's a picture of grace. The second thing that we move on to see is the costliness of repentance. The angel of the Lord said to her, return to your mistress and submit to her. Well, but Jesus, I thought you were going to make me happy. This isn't a picture of happiness. She's running home because she knows there's nowhere else that I can go that's safe. I've been battered and beaten and mistreated, and now I'm pregnant. I want to go home. And the angel says, go home. Go back. Return to your mistress and submit to her. There is a costliness of repentance here that we must take note of. She's going to have to eat a big piece, a big serving of humble pie. Or you can fill in the blank with whatever other language you want to use there. The call to repentance often comes with a side, sometimes it's the main dish, of humility. But it's the hope of the gospel that allows those conversations to occur. It's the hope of the gospel that we have in us. Again, we've been declared righteous. Before these mess-ups come in our lives, it's the gospel that allows that posture to even be there. Our standing with God is unshakable. Romans 8:1 tells us there's therefore no condemnation for those who are in Christ. What that means is we can step into some really, really, really uncomfortable situations and just own it. Own our sin, own our brokenness, own our lashing out. This isn't a call for Abram and Sarai to do this. This is a call for Hagar to do this. And it's the gospel that gives us the humility. It gives us the grace. It gives us the ability to step into those places and even say, I feel like I'm the one that's been wounded here, and yet I ran. Let me step into this. Let me wade into this in the grace of God, knowing that his love for me is unshakable, irrevocable, that we saw last week. It's not based upon how Hagar responds. But again, there is no condemnation. It's the gospel that frees us. It frees us to move in repenting ways, move toward postures of repentance. Notice, she doesn't get a pass because she's mistreated. She's a battered, pregnant woman on the run. And the angel says, you're right. Keep going. I'll pave the way for you. I'll lead you there. I'll find a donkey. I'll make it easy for you to run. That's not what happens. She doesn't get a pass. What that means for you and what that means for me, the call for us, I should say, don't let your wounds be an excuse to continue living a life of sin and rebellion against God. That's what she's ultimately doing. She's running and rebelling against God. And she, according to all of the postures of our world right now, oh, you're you know, intersectionality. So you're a woman, you're from a foreign land, you're pregnant, you've been beaten and mistreated. You have every right in the world to run. And the angel says, yes, back home. Go back to your mistress. The call here is to allow God to meet us in the midst of our brokenness, in the midst of our wounds, and heal them. It's not easy. Again, this isn't a call to ease. It's not a call to happiness. This is not a happy pathway. Please hear me. Many of you have been wounded at the hands of others. That's not an easy thing to walk through. It will take years to walk through by the grace of God. That's the picture here. Allow Jesus to meet you and heal you. At the heart of repentance is to turn around. That's what the angel says to her. Go back home. Return to your mistress. Submit to her. The heart of repentance is turning around. It means to reorient our lives and our priorities in relation to God, to walk the path of obedience that's been set before us. Rarely is it easy. Rarely is it comfortable, but it will often cost you something. This is not a path that she would choose for herself. To go back and to place herself back under the authority of Abram and Sarai. But it is God's path for her life, not her own. The reality is that you and I are not to be trailblazers. Here's the path. Let me go this way. I'm going to make my own path. No, the call is to walk the path of obedience that's been set before us. Again, it's not about our happiness. I can't imagine Hagar sitting here with a big smile on her face. Absolutely. This is a great idea. Almost as good as Sarai's idea that got me to the situation in the first place. It's about holiness. She cannot change Abram and Sarai, nor is she even asked to. You and I have zero control over other people's lives and how they will respond to the working of God in our lives. You are not called to change your spouse's heart. Have a new husband by the weekend. Don't buy the book. It doesn't work. I'll just tell you now. Your kids, your coworkers, your estranged cousin, whoever it is, you have no control over how they respond to the working of God in your life. You are called to be faithful to Him regardless of the cost. I am called to be faithful to Him regardless of the cost. Joyce Baldwin, in her commentary on this text, says, "The Lord delights to show mercy and to give relief to the oppressed, but He also confronts them with their responsibilities." That's what this is a picture of. This angel meeting Hagar, comforting her, loving her, and then sending her on her way in obedience to what God would have her do. How He would have her to live. So we've seen the beauty of grace, the costliness of repentance. Lastly, is the confidence in God's promises. Listen to what the angel then says. The angel of the Lord, verse 10, also said to her, "I will surely multiply your offspring so they cannot be numbered for multitude." And the angel of the Lord said to her, "Behold, you are pregnant, and you shall bear a son. You shall call his name Ishmael, because the Lord has listened to your affliction. He shall be a wild donkey of a man, his hand against everyone, and everyone's hand against him, and he shall dwell over against all his kinsmen." So she called the name of the Lord who spoke to her, "You are a God of seeing." For she said, "Truly here I have seen him who looks after me." Therefore the well was called Beer Lahai Roi. It lies between Kadesh and Bered. And Hagar bore Abram a son, and Abram called the name of his son whom Hagar bore Ishmael. Abram was 86 years old when Hagar bore Ishmael to Abram. So this angel, Jesus, I would contend that this is the pre-incarnate Jesus here, sees her needs, sees her future, And then she lives accordingly to that. One of my favorite texts as of late is Luke chapter 8. Jesus is on his way to heal Jairus' daughter. Everybody's crammed around them in this street area. And Jesus says, "Who touched me?" And the disciples are like, it's like driving a van full of kids. Like, of course they touch you. There's nine of you crammed in the back seat. Like, who didn't touch you? And Jesus says, "No. Someone touched me, for I perceive that power has gone out from me." Verse 47, Luke chapter 8. "And when the woman saw that she was not hidden." I love that. When the woman saw she wasn't hidden. She has nothing to hide. Jesus knows that she's already touched him, that power's gone out, she's been healed. And when she saw that she wasn't hidden, that's the beauty of God's grace for everyone here. When you realize that you're not hidden, she came trembling and falling down before him, declared in the presence of all the people why she had touched him. And then he says, "Daughter, your faith has healed you. Go." It's the very same picture here. Now this woman, Hagar, knows that she's not hidden. She says here, "Truly, I've seen him who looks after me." There's a couple times this pattern occurs from verse 10. "I will surely multiply your offspring." Six times it comes to Abram, one time to Jacob, one time to Isaac. Here is the only time that a woman is given a declaration of future offspring in the Old Testament. Multiply, yes, I will multiply your offspring. But notice that the blessing that God had given Abram in chapter 12 doesn't now revert to her. "And all the nations on earth will be blessed through this offspring." Nope, that's still reserved for Isaac. And we'll see that in the next couple of weeks. Because the promise of blessing comes through the son of the free woman, not the son of the slave woman, as Paul makes the argument in Galatians chapter 4. And the angel gives her here four specific, very specific details about this pregnancy. One, the gender. You're going to bear a son. And then a name. You're going to name him Ishmael. The third thing he says is, here's his personality, right? He's going to be off the rails. He'll be a wild donkey of a man. If you have an old King James, have fun with that one. Be a wild donkey of a man. This has less to do with just kind of arrogance and more about just independence. No one is going to stand in his way. And then the angel gives her what his future is going to be. His hand against everyone and everyone's hand against him. There's going to be animosity between your son and everyone around him for millennia. Thousands of years there's going to be hostility. And you see this moving forward into the tribes in Iran and Iraq and the Middle East and the tension. It all traces back to here. The hatred between Sarai and Hagar continues on into chapter 21. All right, Ishmael will eventually have 12 sons. They become the 12 tribes that oppose, in many ways, the 12 tribes of Israel. This animosity will go on for a long, long time. And notice that Hagar doesn't revel in the information, right? So now I've got more information to go back, and now I can one-up Sarai even more, and I can look on her with much more contempt. Nope. She doesn't revel in the information that she's been given. Rather, she revels in God. "You are a God of seeing. Truly here I have seen him who looks after me." Then names this well, Beer Lahai Roi. It's the living one who sees me. What's profound here is Hagar is the only person in the Bible, be it a woman on top of that, the only person in the Bible to confer a name on God. "You are a God of seeing." She knew the cost, and she went back and obeyed anyways. And what's amazing is She takes this information, goes back, bears a son, and Abram has to believe that this is from the Lord as well, because he calls his son's name Ishmael. And Sarai is strikingly silent. Her plan at the outset of this will be my child through her, and I'll figure it out. Her name's not even mentioned there when she gets back. Her plans, this shortcut that she thought would fulfill everything, actually, it fails for her. It doesn't fail in the grand scheme of God. That's why, again, this whole series of single-minded faithfulness, God's commitment to his purposes and his promises. Even this, like big wrench into the motor, doesn't sideline God's plans for his people. God has heard and God has acted. And in our lives, the shortcuts can't be undone. The call is to believe the word of God, to trust the word of God, to obey the word of God that is unchanging then and unchanging now. Because the reality is for you and I that the safest way home is the long way around. It's not the quickest. Just jump the fence, cut the lock, open the gate. The safest way home is the long way around. It is that way always. Paul writes in Romans 5, verse 20, the law came in order to increase the trespass, but where sin increased, grace abounded all the more. God's grace meets us in our hang-ups and our mess-ups and our screw-ups in ways that we don't even understand. And the call, nonetheless, is still to trust God and not look for shortcuts, because there are no shortcuts to a life of faith built upon the promises that he has given to us. I invite you to the table in just a couple moments. There's one here, there's some at the back. And the table is a reminder for us of God's irrevocable love. Again, this is not an altar. It's profound that this is a table. That's the image that we're given in the New Testament moving forward into all of eternity. But God says, come to the table. Blessed are those who are invited, the Apostle John writes in Revelation 19, to the marriage supper of the Lamb. It's a picture of fellowship, of joy, of laughter, of renewed and restored relationship with God for all of eternity. And it comes because of the imagery here of a broken body and shed blood for us. A German theologian was once asked, can you sum up the Bible in one word? He said the word for. F-O-R, on behalf of. That's what the gospel is. Everything that's been done for us. That's what the table is a reminder of. You don't have to be a member of this church. We would simply say that you believe that Jesus is your Savior, and that you come to this table to be reminded again of that this morning. So there'll be a song playing. You can come to any of these. Go back to your seat with both elements. Then I'll read a text. We'll take the bread. I'll read a text. We'll take the cup together. But you are invited and free to come to any of those tables that you'd like.
Found, I am yours, I am.
The Apostle Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 11, I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Let's eat this morning in remembrance of his body broken for us. In the same way, also he took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Let's drink in remembrance of his blood shed for our sin. I'm going to invite our worship team up for a closing song, Blessed Assurance. And if you would like to be prayed for during this closing song, I'll be off to the side. Would love to do that for you. But let's stand and sing Blessed Assurance. Psalm 139, verses 23 and 24. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts. And see if there be any grievous way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. The call is to walk by faith, not by sight, no matter what the world says. So go with that in mind, knowing that God is for you and is always working for your good and for his glory. You are dismissed. Have a great week.